So after we've seen what a surveying procedure is and how do we do it for a step by step for a cast removable partial denture, the next step is the designing of cast partial denture. And designing is nothing but blueprinting, and that is the foundation of a successful partial denture. Like we see in many monuments, the world famous monuments, they start with a blueprint. And the blueprint, as it is rightly said, if we design it properly, the success and the beauty of the building or the structure is ensured. So again, the designing of cast partial denture or blueprinting or the treatment planning is the extremely important step, and we will learn that in step-by-step manner. First, we'll see the principles of designing of removable partial denture. So the essentials of design are that the design of the removable partial denture is to be simple, comfortable, and harmless to the remaining tissues. So these are the basic requirements. And then comes the differences in support. So there are two types of situations. One is a tooth-supported edentulous area. So both sides there are teeth. And this is Kennedy's class 3, as all of us know. So there the teeth, as they are present on both sides of the edentulous ridge, protect the partial denture from many torsional forces effectively. But when this terminal abutment is lost, the denture is that situation is converted into class 2 or class 1, that is distal extension partial denture. At that time, the torsional forces or the horizontal forces, they are much prominent because of the lack of posterior abutment, and therefore the two situations are entirely different from each other. So tooth supported removable partial denture and tooth and tissue borne partial denture are two different concepts, and the principles vary for both of them. Now why the difference is because the compression of the mucosa and compression of the periodontal ligament happens for different amount. So the compressibility of periodontal ligament is 0.25 microns. So or 25 microns, that is 0.25 millimeters, and the compressibility of the mucosa is 2 millimeters. So 0.25 millimeters and 2 millimeters is a huge difference, and that is why the design considerations are different. So let us see various philosophies of design. The first philosophy is stress equalization, then broad stress distribution, physiologic basing is the third one. So these are the three philosophies of the design of cast partial denture. So the principle of stress equalization, the aim is here to distribute the stresses equal to the tooth and the ridges. So this philosophy advocates the use of a device called a stress breaker. And this device is one that allows movement between the denture base and direct retainer. It can be intracoronal or extracoronal. So even if the direct retainer is intracoronal or extracoronal, doesn't matter. The device, which is a stress breaker, it allows a movement between denture base and the direct retainer. Now you can see in this image that this is the direct retainer, and there is a denture base, and a device which is indicated by an arrow is incorporated so that the movement is allowed and the tooth is not stressed beyond the physiological capacity. Now there are various types of stress breaker. It can be a movable joint between the direct retainer and denture base. It can be a hinge ball and socket type, or it can be a flexible connection between the direct retainer and the denture base. So you can see both the types in figure, which is at the top and at the bottom. So flexible denture base removable partial denture demonstrating steep arc differential between the location differential when the location of the stress breaker hinge results in short radius arm and long radius design incorporating split major connector, locating the point of resilience as far anteriorly as possible, and it reduces the arc differential to the minimum. So these are the philosophies. Now let us come to the advantages and disadvantages of this particular philosophy. The advantages are that it preserves the alveolar support of the abutment. Unnecessary torquing forces on the abutments are avoided. Minimal requirement of direct retention and massaging effect on the soft tissues. However, on the other hand, there are certain disadvantages, like the design is complicated, there is a tendency for fracture, it is difficult to repair, reduced indirect retention, and both vertical and horizontal forces are transmitted on the residual ridges. The second philosophy is of physiologic basing. Soft tissue is recorded in its functioning form by functional impression or relining before the denture delivery. Here, no such device as stress breaker is employed, but the difference in compression of PDL and a mucosa is matched by using a functional impression, or it either at the stage of impressions or after the denture delivery, the process is relined, and that is how the equalization of forces is done. Now, the advantages of this particular philosophy is that intermittent base movement occurs physiologically, and it stimulates the bone and the soft tissue. So, physiological stimulation of bone and soft tissue leads to maintenance of the height and the contour of the structures. It reduces the frequency of reline or rebase process, rebasing of the processes. The design is simple to construct, and the cost minimal retention is used. However, there are certain disadvantages also, that it compresses the soft tissue at rest, there can be premature occlusal contacts, and decreased indirect retention. Denture may not be well stabilized against the lateral forces, and these are the disadvantages. The other philosophy is broad stress distribution, a snowshoe effect. So this advocates the covering as much of area as possible, and that is how the dissipation of forces occurs over a larger surface area, and subsequently there is a reduced forces on the abutments and the ridges. So the advantages are that forces distributed over the large area and multiple clasp assemblies are there, so periodontally weak teeth are supported, it is easier and less expensive to make. Lateral forces may be distributed over as many teeth as possible. Rigid components minimize the rotational movements and provide excellent horizontal stabilization. These partial dentures do not require frequent relining or rebasing. However, the disadvantages are it can be less comfortable as it is a large surface area which is covered, and difficult to maintain oral hygiene because of again the large surface area that is covered. Now, we have seen the philosophies, let us come to the essentials of partial denture design. The first step is to determine how the partial denture is supported. So, to determine the support, whether it is a tooth supported partial denture or a tooth and tissue supported partial denture, that is the first step. So, the tooth supported, in tooth supported partial denture, we have to see the periodontal health, crown root morphologies, crown root ratio, location of tooth in the arch, relationship of tooth and other support units with the opposing dentition, that all these have to be taken into account. For tooth and tissue supported, the quality of residual ridge mucosa, extent covered by the denture base, type and accuracy of impression registration, accuracy of denture base, design, the components of partial denture framework, and anticipated occlusal load, all this needs to be considered. The second step is to connect the tooth and tissue support units, that is major and minor connector design. So this is the second step. The third step is to determine how partial denture will be retained, that is the direct retainers and the indirect retainers. The fourth step is to connect the retention unit to support units with minor connectors. And fifth step is to outline and join edentulous area to established design components. So these are the five steps. As we all know that failing to plan is planning to fail. So very, very important to plan all this very meticulously. And the color coding which is used is as follows. Blue is for acrylic, brown is for metal, red is for tripod marks, areas on the teeth that will be prepared, relieved or contoured, and rest seats, etc. Survey lines, black. Another soft tissue undercuts in black, and other information is in black color. So like you can see in this picture, blue, brown, red and black colors are used for drawing the design. Now coming to the step-by-step procedures in designing, we examine the occluding diagnostic casts first, then mark the areas of rest seats to be and the areas to be reshaped with red pencil. Then we do the surveying. Now these are the rest seats area on terminal abutments. Then we draw the denture base extensions. Then we draw the major and minor connectors. Then we draw the cast stops. Then we formulate the retentive elements, reciprocal elements, and this is how the completed design looks like. Now looking at the individual cases, Kennedy's class 1 partial denture design. So here we have terminal abutments. Like in this case, there are two premolars. So we do the surveying and determine the location of the undercut. Now distobuccal undercut can have a T or a half T class. Mesiobuccal undercut can have a wrought wire class. Now rigid reciprocal units are planned over here. And indirect retention is another important step, and it has to be planned because it gives the much needed stability against the dislodging forces. So here is the indirect retention being added as far anteriorly as possible. Now Kennedy's class 2 partial denture design, unilateral edentulous area. So here the rule being followed that join the line, which joins the two terminal abutments, draw perpendicular to the line, and that indicates the location of the indirect retention. So class 3 is quite straightforward. It has a quadrilateral design configuration. So two terminal abutments on each sides because it is a modification area. So now this Kennedy's class 3 partial denture has been subdivided by Applegate into three different groups. Group 3, the very short saddles, abutments are healthy and minimum bore loss. Group B, abutments are not able to support and provide bracing. The saddle or the edentulous span is long and there is bone resorption around the abutment teeth. And group C is the saddle which is exceptionally long, abutment unable to provide any support. So these are the three groups as per the Applegate. So we have to take into account different factors for three different designs. Coming to Kennedy's class 4 partial denture design, here we have again the quadrilateral configuration and two terminal abutments on each side. Now class 4, the movement of this type of RPD and resulting stresses transmitted to the abutment are unlike the pattern seen in any other type of prosthesis. Aesthetic placement of teeth may necessitate their placement anterior to the crest of the residual ridge, and that results in potential tilting leverages. Shorter the edentulous area, less will be the harmful leverages. Strategic class position should be used. Quadrilateral configuration in class 4 with anterior class placed anterior and posterior as far as possible would be ideal. Major connector should be rigid and broad coverage should be used in maxillary arch. A functional type of impression if the edentulous area is excessive may be required. Now here the aesthetic is very important. Rotational forces can be minimized by retaining serviceable teeth. Use of labial fringe for retention. Indirect retention is not required if ideal quadrilateral configuration is followed. So to conclude with, a successful removable partial denture fabrication requires knowledge of principles of design, sound clinical judgment, very good laboratory support and patient's cooperation. And all these factors are important. And in this session, we have learned about the knowledge about principles of design, surveying and various design principles. And although this is one of the factors, but the other factors are very important, like lab support, patient's cooperation and clinical judgment. So here we end this session. Thank you for watching us.